We're going to make off a piece of SY flex or SY cable. We're going to be making off 3 core 2.5 using a 20S gland pack. I'm going to have the camera in really nice and close when I made this off. I've made a video previously on how to terminate or make off SY flex, but back in those days the camera work wasn't as good as maybe as it could be now. Maybe the sound quality wasn't as good. So first of all, let's look at the gland pack. We've got a CXT20S. 20 the size of the hole that you will need to knock into your enclosure, and S saying the body of it is small. Why did I select that one? When we turn over, we look here. First column here is the conductor sizes, and I told you that ours were 2.5, and across the top, the number of conductors. So we've got 3 core. So 2.5, 3 core says that that is a 20S required to terminate it. Hence, this is the gland pack I've selected. So we're going to use this pack, and we're going to terminate this cable, which is 3 core. And the subtle difference now between video 1 and video 2 is that the cores are actually identified brown, blue, and green and yellow. The previous video I did, we had two black conductors labeled 1 and 2, and we could identify one as neutral and one as line, and a green and yellow conductor. So there's a subtle difference on that. Hopefully we'll get some better camera work and some better audio, and you'll see me how to terminate SY cable or SY flex, whichever you call it. So we're going to terminate our SY flex as if it's going into our consumer unit, okay, coming into the bottom, in order that we can judge the required length. The jobs that are in the workshop all go from a consumer unit generally to a 16 amp industrial socket outlet. So we'll start the consumer unit and we tend to work our way around. It's about how we're going to fit the gland on here, and then obviously how we're going to attach it to the enclosure. It's subtly different when we're going into the plastic 16 amp socket, but we generally start the consumer unit and work our way down. Once we've had a go at making one SY flex end off, we can apply the knowledge in order to get the other end. So with that in mind, I'm going to need to work out my length of my conductor. So I like it to be as long as the enclosure again, so I've got it so it comes back round. So that would be a good starting point at about that length. However, what generally happens is my students start making the end off and they haven't inserted things like the shroud. Okay, so we're going to start off with the shroud. So gland pack, brand new. Generally we give our students a brand new gland pack to start with, taking our knife away from your thumb towards your chum. Cheers, Chris. Taking out our items. Let's look at those items that we get in our gland pack. So we get two of everything. We get two shrouds. So these here being our shrouds. We get two shrouds, two earthing rings, often called on site, so I take a lot of stick for this, often called on site banjos. Okay, they are earthing rings for the questions on the EFIX Apprentice Hub. They're earthing rings when you're looking at the questions at sitting guilds and EAL layout, so they're earthing rings. And then we've got the actual glands themselves, look very similar to steel or armoured. So if you're picking them up at college out of a box, just check that they look appropriately. So we've got a nut, got a 20 mil lock nut. In this case, it's brass. We've got two brass rings with each of them. And then obviously we've got the actual body itself, okay? And that body has a split down it. Okay, so make sure you've got that one. Often my students will get confused and they will bring out a steel or armored one. Generally, we do steel or armored before we do SY flex. So we've got a set of two of those. We're only going to be making one off, so I can get rid of those to one side. And we've got left as if we're making off just the one end. Shroud, gland body, 20 mil nut, two, what are we going to call those? Let's call those two washers, brass washers, and our earthing ring. We're going to trap our actual braiding between those, and we'll see that during the process. So shroud's got to go on first, so we're going to need to take the nip off the end of the actual shroud. We do that by inserting it into here first, and pulling nice and hard, and maybe you can see the area here where the colour changes. So we've got a little colour change between the two. That's the part of which I'm going to nip it off with my knife. So I'm going to take that. I've got a wooden board, so I'm just going to put it down like so. I'm going to make a little mark against it. I'm going to take that end off, just like so. Okay. Hopefully it's quite firm when it goes on. So hopefully it's quite tricky to get it on. So see already, it doesn't flop or go down. So that's got a nice look. I can push against it. So there's some resistance there. So that can go on. My students will say to me, it's not a problem, Gaz, if I forget the first one, because I can bring it on from the other end. So you could have passed it all the way down the other end. I always say to them, if the circuit was of a reasonable length and maybe fixed to the structure of the building, could you obviously run the shroud up it? No, you couldn't. You'd end up having to take the actual gland off. So shroud goes on. Okay, we're going to go for our length. So we're approximately twice the length of the consume unit. And I'm going to take it to about there. We're going to need this little bit. We're going to need the gland body to go on. So let's get that on next. So gland body goes on like so. Sometimes you have to loosen off that. That there puts a little rubber seal in there to actually lock off against the actual SY flex in order to have a moisture barrier. So just make sure that that's just backed off slightly. Slides on nice and easily. So cable length, I'm going to go for there, okay, for this one. And now I'm going to go round fairly firmly with my knife. So I'm in a good position. So I take my knife fairly firmly round, like so, all the way round. Okay. And then I've got to see if I can get this off. Now, sometimes you can actually physically pull that off. You can actually pull and go. So as I go, I'm just twisting it. So as I'm pulling, I'm just giving it a little twist as I go. So it's coming off, just a little twist. Pull with a twist, pull with a twist. So pull, twist, 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 twist. And we're finding we're working off the PVC. So the PVC's gone away. Almost looks like a snake skin. You can actually see the imprint of the braiding in there, the steel braiding. Okay, so we can put that to one side. What we've got now is we've got to actually bulge this out, okay, in order to get about that much braiding in order that we can earth the braiding. We'll talk in the classroom that we only need to earth it from one end. It may be that you earth it inadvertently from both, but you definitely only have to earth it from one end, but you cannot use it as a circuit protective conductor. It is CBC inside the cable itself, okay, and we have to earth the braiding, but we couldn't use the braiding as a separate CPC if there wasn't one in the actual cable itself. So your choice now, you're gonna need one of your rings, your brass rings to go on. You can put it on now if you want, so I'll slide that on next. To sit in like so, and now what we've got to do is get our braiding to sit round here before we insert our second ring to squash the two together. So what I end up doing is I bubble this down. So I take it and I just bubble it down. So I bring that bubble all the way down to about, what we're talking about, 3 or 4 centimeters from the end. So that's the part with the knife, 3 or 4 centimeters. And I'm going to lose this section here. Now this, with the side cutters I got, can be quite tricky to do. So you need to get your side cutters in. I don't like these ones, I might change them. Reason being, there's a little hole inside there, so they're not the greatest side cutters in the world. Let's change them over for a conventional set with no splitting holes. Let's see if we can just break through the braiding. Doesn't matter if it's straight, just got to get through it all the way around. There's probably other techniques to doing this. Remember, if you've got your own technique, feel free to leave a positive comment below. So we've got that much off at the moment. Okay, have the braiding gone away? Better side cutters, folks. My students, they all love the wee-ha ones, but they're not always the best for things like this. So we've got 3 or 4 centimeters there of the actual braiding itself. It's still too long, okay? And what we're gonna need to do is open that out. We need to take maybe our braddle and just run that through there. We could take a terminal screwdriver in order to open it up, or we could potentially use something like a scriber. So I'm gonna use my actual braddle. So just going to pull through. Try not to do too many at once. That's the biggest mistake. People try and do too many. So I'm just opening these out. And this is down one side. So I'm just splitting those through like so until I'm down to the base. So I've actually separated one side, okay, from the other side. Okay. And we've got that split now. I'm going to do the same here on the other side. Just going to pull these ones out. So we've got no tangling as we go through. So there we go. So what we're going to try and do is keep a 50-50 split. So I want 50% one side and 50% the other. So maybe a few more just to detangle just there. Okay. So we've got 50% one side and 50% the other side. Okay. So maybe I'll put a few more round. Actually, there's a couple there that could be benefit from being on the other side. Okay, so we've got approximately 50-50 split. Okay, so we're gonna take those. Some people at this stage do the quarter of a turn at this point, so they bring it round, but we're just gonna twist these up to to start with. Some people do a quarter of a turn. I think I might have done a quarter of a turn previously. Okay, so we're going to make those tightly twisted together. And we want them opposite sides, 180 degrees apart. So I've got one each side. So I've got to set this side and I set that side. Just go again, a little bit tighter. Always more difficult for me because obviously I'm trying to stay out of the way of the camera. So there we go. So we've got our two side splits. One, so if you look there, we're trying to be 180 degrees apart. Okay, so let's see if we can now perhaps just trim them back a little bit. I'm going to trim them again in a minute. And we've now got to line up our actual gland itself. So we can see at 180 degrees on our gland, we've also got two holes or slices down the actual gland through the threads. And we need to bring it up to where we are within the actual gland itself. So in like so. Okay, so we're in that position there now. Okay, so we're nearly there. Not much more to do really for this demonstration. I think I did a slightly longer one before. Now what we're gonna do is we're actually gonna put the other washer on and then the actual nut will go that way round to tighten. So actually we wanna bring our braiding round the same way. So that would pull through that way and that would go that way. In other words, the way the nut goes on and goes round is the same in which we're gonna follow around this braiding that we're trying to earth against this body itself. You're gonna bring it round so it's almost backs up to where it was before. So this one's coming round here. You want this other one to come and almost meet it, but not quite. Don't get it too precisely right behind it. So fairly close to it, okay, like so. And then we'll bring this one round and we back it to where approximately the other one is. So what I recommend now you do is just check that these are nice and tight. So just tighten those back off again. So that's nice and tight. And are we tightening that? Yep. And we're tight there. So we're gonna bring that back round onto the back of this one. And this one back round onto the back just here. Okay, so we've got those into position. Just check it's all the way in. So I apologize about that. Yep, okay, so we're in those positions there and there. It's best to spend a little bit of time now just making sure this lays well within here. Okay, so poke that one around there and there. I'll hold them just for a second into position, like so. And we'll drop the other washer on so we can sort of hold it semi into position. So all the way up, you can now see that we've got to just work on trying to get these so they stay within the two rings now, like so. What you end up doing is using a screwdriver or the back of your knife at some point in order to hold those into position. This stage here, you may or may not want to strip off the conductors. Okay, I tend to leave it for a slightly later part of it. Let's introduce the consumer unit. Okay, so on the bottom of there, it's already been drilled out appropriately, and we've even got the position for our earthing ring to go on. Okay, as well, hopefully that's in the right position. Sometimes people remove all the paint here, and I totally agree with that. We stopped doing it a few years ago, taking off all the paint on here. So we've left it like this, so we're relying actually on the connection of the bolt and the nut, etc. So let's bring that one round. Let's push that on next. Okay, like so. And we're going to keep them up and locked into position like that. Okay, and then we can pop into our actual consumer unit like so. And we can take our nut and go on the inside. Okay, at the moment they're sort of pulling out, that's not a problem. On goes our nut. Okay, and this will be mounted obviously on the wall. Okay, and we're gonna need to make sure that we line up here. I generally put a bolt through here at this stage. I put a bolt in here to stop it moving because it can sometimes move left or right. So in order that we can get it in and correct, obviously we're doing it at the moment with our fingers, this is where the back of a knife comes in handy in order to push that back into here. So I've pushed that back into position. Okay, whether I be on that side, obviously you can't turn it around in the real world. Okay, on that side. So I'm gonna need to use my knife or my screwdriver just to make sure that they stay in. So I push those in with my screwdriver. It up. We've got some round the back as well here. So I'll just show you around here. So you've got some that have come out of there as well. So you've got to make sure that you get those in. So I loosen it back off again. Get in between our two washers, hold them into place, tighten it up with your fingers. And now I have a little feel round. I can't feel any whiskers at all. Obviously in the real world, you couldn't just spin it round. Okay, so we've started to show that there's no whiskers now poking out. This gives you the option now, so with my back of my knife, I can just push those ones back in, whichever side they were, just push those back into position. I'll take my screwdriver and just poke those back in. Once I'm happy with them being in position, obviously make sure, in this case, my earthing ring is in position, and then we can lock these off, so we can actually tighten those off. So we've got a 20 mil locking spanner, lock nut spanner in here, okay, and an adjustable or a pair of grips here. So I'll get that and we'll lock that off next. But first and foremost, we've made sure none of these whiskers are poking out the side. And we did that by using the knife or terminal screwdriver in order to get them in. Okay, so we'll lock that off next. So we've got lock nut spanners here at the college. We've got 20 and 25. Okay, so we can use those if we want to. So that can go on and go onto our actual nut inside here. And then we've got the ability to take adjustable or a pair of grips in order that we can lock it off. Okay, so we can tighten between the two. So we can make sure that's super tight. Obviously this will be mounted on a surface, so you won't be pulling it against the bench in order to make sure that's super tight. So we need to make sure that our earthing ring is in line with our hole, maybe put a bolt in it, and that we make this sure this is super tight. So we tighten between here and here. When it is tight, we check that none of the actual braidings are poking out. And then obviously we're just ready to terminate our end, insert a fly lead, etc., so we can take a fly lead between the two. We'll jump across to a job that's already been terminated and look at how they've done the rest of it. But remember, the big difference with this cable, so I'll just show you the conductors that we've moved over to in the workshop, actually has our conductors identified by colour. So we're okay with those. So we've actually got them identified as brown currently for line, blue for neutral, and green and yellow for CPC. The job I'm going to show you next may not, it might be all in black or it might be in coloured. It depends on which learner's job that we jump into next. Super important we get it tight, because the braiding will be earth through this earthing ring to the earth bar. Okay, our CPC will run through separately through our cable. The shroud will be put on afterwards. We can lock it off here. Okay, this is generally locked off either with fingers or just gently with a pair of grips or an adjustable spanner, not super tight. It ruins the seal in here if you try and wrench it up. So firmly into position, then our shroud can go on, obviously, for a finished look. Let's cut away to one of my students' jobs and see what they've got up to. So we jumped into one of my students' jobs, and this was the original two black conductors. So this was black and this was black, and they've oversleeved it in blue and brown to identify as line and neutral. They are identified with numbers 1 and 2. It doesn't matter which one you choose for which. So they've got the sleeving on. The cable I've just shown you just arrived at college, and before I leave, I was trying to just show my students that actually they may find that the cable moving forward is brown, blue, and green, and yellow. So we've got both options here. Previous video presentation talked about them being both black, and some of my testing videos are as well that are on the industrial plug and socket. But the cable I've just shown you is identified by colour. So here we've got the internal lock nut super tight. I've just showed you that. This is the bolt I haven't shown you coming through from the underside. This comes through to strap against the actual earthing ring. This separate fly lead comes up to the earth bar. So this one takes the CPC straight down and through this bolt connects onto the gland body below. And that gland body below, like so, if I just drop the camera. So that goes onto the gland body just there. So that gland body just there is obviously connected to the earth bar from above. So that gland body is now earthed. The separate CPC from the conductor comes through here and goes out and down. We've got way one, and way one for the actual outgoing circuit. The student's got an industrial socket, so of course there's RCD protection. We preferred it to be an RCBO, but of course cost at college, we haven't got one. It's also a 16 amp socket down there, so the fuse here also has to be 16 amp, something my students have done. And hopefully this video has been some help.